So good evening. So my name's Jose Alvarez, and I teach here at the law school. And I'm honored to have been asked by my dear friend Tom Buergenthal to introduce the 7th annual Emilio Mignone lecture. And the event is a collaboration between the International Center for Transitional Justice, or the ICTJ, and the Center for Human Rights and Global Justice here at NYU. And the ICTJ has operated since 2001 to assist societies in transition that are addressing legacies of massive human rights violations and to build civic trust in state institutions as protectors of human rights. And in the aftermath of mass atrocity and repression, this group assists institutions and civil society in considering measures to provide truth, accountability, and redress for past abuses. And for its part, NYU Center for Human Rights and Global Justice expands the rich array of teaching opportunities, research, clinical, and internship, and publishing activities that we have here at NYU on this subject. This lecture is held annually with the aim of bringing together leading human rights activists, policymakers, academics, and practitioners to explore transitional justice and related issues. Over the years, we've hosted in this series leading figures, including Richard Goldstone, Helen Clark, Radhika Komaswamy, and Mr. Nair. Past lectures have tackled topics like the nexus between justice and development and the Arab Spring. And this event is growing, as you see, into a leading public event and doing justice to the memory of Emilio Fermín Mignone, a recognized Argentinian human rights activist whose daughter, Monica, was among thousands of victims of enforced disappearance during the military regime's dirty war. We are very proud to have Mignone's granddaughter, Agustina del Carril. I believe she's here. And we have many other folks that I am not going to introduce because it will take all night. But it gives me great pleasure to introduce the man at the center of tonight's events, Judge Thomas Buergenthal. And you have in your programs a brief bio. He is, of course, a professor now at George Washington University Law School. As one of the youngest survivors of Auschwitz, Judge Buergenthal became a leading advocate and pioneer of international law, dedicated his career to protecting human rights around the globe. You have his bio, as I say, but let me just say a few words about his impressive achievements. Tom Buergenthal served 2 terms as judge in the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, writing some of the most influential decisions regarding state responsibility for systematic human rights violations in the Americas, including, as the students in this room will probably know, the Velasquez-Rodriguez decision, which made clear that when you ratify a human rights treaty that ensures the protection of human rights, governments assume a duty to protect human rights victims, including the duty to prosecute private parties who violate the right to life, including those who are acting not for the state itself, but through self-styled private militias. Judge Buergenthal served also on the Commission on the Truth for El Salvador. And in 2000, he was elected to the International Court of Justice, the ICJ, where he served for 10 years. As chair of the Committee of Conscience at the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum, he brought forward the conversation on genocide after failures to act in Bosnia and Rwanda. And of course, he's no stranger to this august group, the ICTJ, where he serves on its advisory board. And he's certainly also part of this law school. In 1960, we awarded him an honorary Tilden, it can't have been 1960. No, okay, we awarded him his honorary Tilden's, that would have made you way too old. You don't get an honorary doctorate 40 years ago, I don't. Yeah,
but I deserved the one afterwards.
And this was our Tilden Juris Doctorate, which is very fitting since Judge Buergenthal studied here as a Root Tilden scholar himself. He also received a Master of Laws and Doctor of Juridical Science from that lesser school in Cambridge, Massachusetts, Harvard Law School. And in 2005, our NYU Law School Association bestowed on him its Alumni Achievement Award. Now, those are just some of the many deserved honors that have come his way. Others include the Golda Butcher Medal for Excellence in Human Rights, the Manley O. Hudson Medal from the American Society of International Law, and the Gruber Prize for International Justice. His many publications are too many to mention, but I will just mention one. Is probably most striking, A Lucky Child. And this book, a memoir of surviving Auschwitz as a young boy, recounts his daunting and miraculous years growing up under Nazi rule, his arrival at Auschwitz at the age of 10, his life in Germany after the war, his arrival in the United States in 1951. It's a moving and vivid account of his family's removal to the Jewish ghetto in Kielce, Poland, his time as a child laborer in a work camp, his years at Auschwitz, and the days-long death march to the Sachsenhausen concentration camp in Germany. It's fair to say, as has been noted by others, that Judge Buergenthal's lifelong commitment to human rights sprang from the ashes of Auschwitz. I first met Judge Buergenthal during his years as judge on the Inter-American Court of Human Rights. I was in awe of this man, obviously, who had achieved so much that he had managed the impossible, and to this day, I think, unprecedented. He had managed to become a judge on an international court as a U.S. national when, of course, the U.S. was not even a member of that court. He achieved this because of his reputation and integrity. He was nominated to that court by Costa Rica, which had adopted Tom Buergenthal as one of its own, at least for this purpose. I suspect that the US, if the US had not done the same when it came time to fill a position on the International Court of Justice, some other country would have put Tom on that court in The Hague. But let me say that those of us who know Tom best have been in awe of him not only because of his achievements. We have been struck by how he has managed all of this, this remarkable life at the cutting edge of international law and justice, while being so down to earth and genuinely humble. Unlike many exalted international lawyers that I have come to know but I will refuse to name, Judge Buergenthal has always been a master of understatement, particularly when it comes to not trumpeting his own incredible achievements. Even the title of his quietly understated and therefore all the more devastating memoir stresses happenstance, his quote, luck in surviving Auschwitz, in being able to live among Germans after the war and thereby avoiding self-destructive and all-consuming hatred for the rest of his life, in being able to rely on others at all stages of his life. With all due respect, Tom, being lucky does not begin to explain your life or why so many of us have turned out to hear you tonight. As your own memoir indicates, there's at least one other reason. Consider this passage from A Lucky Child. While I do not believe that I survived the Holocaust only in order to devote my life to the protection of human rights, I do believe that having survived, I have an obligation to try to do all I can to spare others, wherever they may be, from suffering a similar or worse fate. The terrible crimes and cruelties inflicted in many parts of the world since the Holocaust have not weakened my commitment to human rights one jot. Instead, they have reinforced my belief in the need to work ever harder to promote human rights education at all levels and to build an international and national legal and political framework that will make governmental violation of human rights increasingly difficult. As that brief passage suggests, you have managed to avoid the enervating cynicism to which others have succumbed because you have had the strength of character and inner drive to make the world a better place through law. Now, a few words about what you're going to expect tonight. This year, we will not have a traditional lecture. Reflections on the landscape of justice from Auschwitz to The Hague will take the form of a conversation between Judge Buergenthal and David Tolbert, the president of the ICTJ. David Tolbert is a leading expert himself on international law and transitional justice. He previously served as registrar of the Special Tribunal for Lebanon and assistant secretary general and special expert to the UN Secretary General on the United Nations assistance to the Khmer Rouge trials. From 2004 to 2008, Mr. Tolbert served as Deputy Chief Prosecutor of the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia, and he previously served as Deputy Registrar of the ICTY and Chef de Cabinet to President Gabriel Kirk McDonald. He has also authored a number of publications on international justice. Together, Judge Buergenthal and Mr. Tolbert will explore how notions of international justice, including accountability, education, and the rule of law relate to Judge Buergenthal's unique personal story and career. Their conversation will be followed by a brief question and answer period. And with that, I turn it over to David Tolbert to conduct our conversation.
Thank you. Many thanks, Jose, and I think that's a brilliant introduction and a hard act to follow, Tom. I think we've got a tough act to follow.
But, exactly. But we're good friends.
So but we're good friends. So I have a few questions for Tom. I do want to thank the law school, the NYU Law School, and the Center for Human Rights and Global Justice for being a partner with ICTJ on this event now for a number of years. You've had very good events, and again tonight. I would like to really am delighted that Representative the Mignone family is here tonight. And so that means a lot to us. And we have a very distinguished audience here with a lot of important people and those who've contributed to the cause of international justice and transitional justice. I did want to recognize my predecessor and the President Emeritus of ICTJ, Juan Mendez, who's sitting in the front row. I'm very honored to have Juan here with us tonight. So it's very good to see you, Juan. Tom, I mean, I think I will also, I'm holding up, I think, a slightly different edition than Jose of the A Lucky Child, but I thought we would start there because before we move into your very illustrious international career, because it is such, as Jose has said, it's such a remarkable book, from the Khalsa ghetto to Auschwitz, from the death march in Auschwitz to the next step in the line, which is another concentration camp, and your survival. And of course, I've known you for a long time and know you well, and I was rereading the book for maybe the third time the other night in preparation, and I was saying, how is Tom going to get around this one every three or four pages? How is he going to survive? And it's a great tale of a great story of survival in the face of in the most extraordinary of situations, and the triumph of the human spirit that you show as a child here and making your way through a very, very difficult set of circumstances, and then being separated from your parents, losing your father, and then the incredible story of reuniting with your mother some years later. So it's a very inspiring and moving story. But one of the things that you and I've talked about before is you didn't write this book sort of immediately after the fact. This came along about six decades later, more or less, right? And we in a previous conversation, you said to me that this is a very different book that you wrote all these years later than what you would have written immediately after your time in Auschwitz and so forth, or 5 years later, in that kind of aftermath period. And I'm wondering if you might talk a little bit about why you say that. What's the difference? What's the difference in perspective? And what are the origins of that difference?
Yes. First of all, let me say, this is a room that I've known as a student. And it's nice to be back and to be here rather than there. And a university, a law school that I'm most grateful for, scholarship which I had, which enabled me to study here. So I'm delighted to be back at this law school. I must say, it doesn't. The room hasn't changed somehow. And looking at the chairs, they seem to be very worn. I don't think anything has happened since my day. But back to the book. And Jose, many thanks for your kind words. You know, I didn't realize when you asked me, you know, how would it have been different? Mm-hmm. I remember I was asked once in the Holocaust Museum to talk about the death march out of Auschwitz, which was a terrible period. So many people died along the road. And as I started to write my talk, I suddenly realized that I no longer felt the cold, the terrible cold in January of 1945. Polish weather, the hunger. And when I started to write, I was writing as if I was talking about somebody else. Whereas if I had written it right afterward, not only would I have felt the cold, but I would also have felt a tremendous hatred. So I really needed the perspective of many, many years, I think 50, some almost 60 years later, that I wrote the book. And I think the book really represents more the type of experience that I feel made me who I am. And if it had written it 5 years later, it would have been the wrong sort of book. It wouldn't have been me that I am today. So I'm delighted I waited. Of course, as I was writing it, I kept continuously saying, I wish my mother were here, because there are so many questions that I would have liked to answer. And I think all of us have the same thing with our parents. But as I was writing the book, I often sort of said, did this really happen? Or am I imagining that it happened? Mm-hmm. And then I said, I would have liked to ask my mother, whom I always called Mutti, did this really happen, or did you talk about it? So it's not the book I would have written, but I think in many ways it's a more important book.
There are a lot of moving scenes in the book, Tom, and I can think of dozens, but the one that struck me the deepest, I think you were in the work camp and some of the detainees tried to flee and they were captured and they were brought back and they were forced to build gallows. And they then were marched to the gallows, and other prisoners were being forced to put the noose around the neck of these escapees. And one of them, with very trembling hands, wasn't able to do that, for whether out of fear or for moral reasons. And the prisoner who was being ready to be hanged turned and kissed the hand of his fellow prisoner, and actually stuck his neck through the noose. And I think you talked about it in the book as a great act of moral resistance, which takes the same courage as physical, takes the same courage as physical resistance, and is a very moving moving scene. And I just wondered if you had wanted to just reflect on that. It's interesting. One of the reviews of the book, I'm sure you've read all of the reviews, of course. I checked a few out.
And like we read footnotes to check our names.
Exactly. But I think it was Publishers Weekly said something along the lines, if I remember correctly, that your career and human rights was probably very affected by that kind of scene and scenes and also in Auschwitz and so forth, and this idea of moral resistance. And I'm interested in your reaction to that and how those kind of scenes and those acts of courage and resistance affected you ultimately as a human rights lawyer and a career in international justice.
Yes, I think I was always surprised, especially when I came to the United States, when there was tremendous criticism of the failure of Jews, us, to resist. And it usually came from people who had no idea what it was like in those camps. But to me, it always seemed that the sort of moral resistance that was shown in the moral courage that was shown was so much more important, than it said so much more about our people than, say, the Warsaw Ghetto. It was easy to fight and die because you knew you were going to die anyway. But the things that people did when they, the mother who would go instead of the child, the friend, the old man, those things, those are the things that say something about the people who were in the camps and who, most of them, who died. So I think we really haven't paid too much attention to really those type of things that happened in the camp, hundreds of those things. Resistance. A small example that I always cite, and it's really nothing, is my father never wore a hat in the camp. And particularly because whenever you wore a hat in this terrible weather in Poland, when any German came by, you had to take it off. And he said, I'm just going to do it. I'm not going to greet him. He doesn't deserve it. Mm. So they used to call him a Meshuggener because in the winter, he wouldn't wear a hat. But it's a small little thing, but it showed, and there were hundreds much more serious things than this. I was very much influenced by that sort of courage, by the honesty, that when people didn't steal bread from somebody else or gave somebody a piece of bread when the piece of bread meant living or dying, that influenced me probably more than any sort of resistance when you knew you were going to be shot one way or the other.
So is Publishers Weekly right, and they trace your kind of commitment to human rights back to those kind of issues of moral resistance, or is it a more complicated process?
I think it's much more complicated. Yeah. When I ask myself, you know, why did I go into this, it's never quite as heroic as it sounds.
Yeah. Well, I did also, there. This book, A Lucky Child, is not the only book about your time in Auschwitz and so forth, and the camps. There's another book that I can't get my hands on because it's I could get my hands on it, but it's a Norwegian, and I'm not too good at Norwegian. And as I understand it, you're the only one who has a copy of this book in English.
American University Library has one.
Has one copy. Well, I didn't get down there to be able to read this, but I was, it's called, so the book's called Tommy, as I was saying, and I'm just wondering if you might tell us a little bit about Odd Nansen. I may be not pronouncing the name correctly, but there's quite a story in the book about that, and since I can't read the book, I'd be interested to hear a little bit about it.
Actually, part of the book is also part of his diary. Right. Odd Nansen, the son of Fridtjof Nansen, the famous North Pole explorer, was in the camp in Sachsenhausen with me. He was there much longer than I. And he kept a diary throughout his imprisonment. And there is a section in the book that is then that he actually takes and puts into the Tommy book.
Right.
Basically, Mr. Nansen, I think I owe him in many ways the first sort of reflection on hatred, because even in the camps he behaved very differently. And what struck me particularly when his book was published after the war, when his diary was published, he gave all of the money from the German edition to German refugees. And I said to him, I can't understand this. Why would you, this was when I was still in Germany at 16 years old, why would you give them the money from the income of this book? And then we started to discuss what the consequences are of hatred and where it leads to. And do we really want to go the cycle again and again and again? And that was sort of the beginning of my reflection on where does hatred really lead to? What does it produce? Mm-hmm. And the importance of reconciliation. He was a wonderful man. I also owe him my life, because when I was in Sachsenhausen, on the death march, my legs were frozen, my toes, and I lost two toes and was they operated, believe it or not, in Sachsenhausen. But that meant when you went to the infirmary there, you never got out. They had wonderful facilities in the infirmaries. They were there for inspectors to see. And then if you spend 3 weeks there, you were taken away. And when the Norwegians and the Danes were taken out of the camp close to the end of the war, when he left, he bribed one of the people who were wardens to make sure don't let the kid be sent out of the revere, as it was called. And otherwise, I would never have made it out. And then what was so nice, after the war, he'd give me a piece of paper to write him after the war. He was sure we were all going to survive. And of course, I lost the piece of paper. And we reunited actually in 1948. I saw him, and that's when he decided to write the second part of...
I think you wrote a letter to him addressed to Odd Jansen, Norway, right?
And he was
somehow
a very,
another...
Yes, he's a very famous man. Actually, just maybe I could say a word about him. Fridtjof Nansen, who was was High Commissioner for Human Rights in the League of Nations time, the Nansen passport, some of you may have heard about, he was the one. When Quisling came to power in Norway, Quisling said, if Fridtjof Nansen were alive today, he would be number one member of my party. And his son, Odd Nansen, with whom I was in the camp, gave a press conference and said, my father was not a traitor to Norway nor a hater of Jews. He was immediately arrested, spent 3.5 years first in camps in Norway and then in Sachsenhausen. So he's went through tremendous experiences, but always kept his humanity, helping others throughout the entire period.
Not to talk about him too much, but he did, I think, help establish UNICEF as well.
Yes, yes.
So we could say, perhaps, Tom, you were an inspiration for UNICEF. Would that be a fair conclusion?
I wish I could claim that.
I thought maybe we'd shift and talk a little bit about your career and.
But you never asked me a question which I always get and always expect to get. You should know that I don't know what questions David is going to ask me, because I always find doesn't do for a good. But the question you always ask me, where does the title come from my book?
I was going to ask that at the end, Tom.
Oh,
I think you've stolen my thunder. So, where does the title "Lucky Child" come from? The last time we did this, I did it first. I was going to do it last, but just to try to keep you honest. But
I always anticipate David's questions, and then now you have to keep it in the same order at least.
You told me this was my show. So, Tom, the title "Lucky Child."
Yes.
Where does it come from?
Finally. I always like to tell the story because it tells so much about my mother. In 1939, we were in a town in Poland, in Kielce, waiting to be taken to England. We had visas to go to England, and the British consul was getting ready to get us out of Poland to England. Incidentally, we never made it because the Germans invaded Poland on the day on which we were supposed to leave. So, but my mother, during that time while we were waiting for the visa, was talked into by a girlfriend to go to a fortune teller. And the fortune teller, my mother was very young at the time. I was born when she was only 20 years old. And I was, I think, 5 or 6 years old at the time. Fortune teller looked at her and said, you're married, you have a child, and your family is going to go through terrible things. Well, in 1939, for a Jewish family in Poland, you didn't need a fortune teller to to tell you those things. But then she said, but you have a son, and your son is ein Glückskind, a lucky child, and he's going to get through it all unscathed. And so after the war, my mother, she always said, I don't believe in this hocus pocus, but the reality is she really believed it. I had to be alive when everybody said to her, the children his age, nobody survived, and it's not possible. She insisted that I was alive. So the Glückskind always was something, in German that means a lucky child, sustained her through some very difficult time, a search of 2 years after the war before she found me. And that's why I thought this title had to be in the book. And of course, I was also very lucky because despite what I went through, I'm still here to talk about it. That's the title. Did I tell the story the same way? Or
you told it better this time. You're getting better with the answers. Next time, we'll make sure it stays at the end. So, but Tom, maybe I thought that we'd shift a little bit over to from a lucky child to some of your later career, particularly as an international judge, as a human rights expert, because you've made great contributions there in these fields. And of course, you were a founding judge on the Inter-American Court of Human Rights and later president. And that court has had an enormous impact in Latin America. And I was, and I think, as I mentioned, the Rodriguez case and the enforced disappearances and some very important precedents that were established and has made an enormous difference in the region. And I was wondering if you might give us some reflections and comments on the role of regional human rights courts. We have a strong system, obviously, in Latin America. We have a strong system in Europe. The rest of the world, there are not really strong regional mechanisms on human rights. And also, maybe put it in the context of we also have other international courts that have emerged, the International Criminal Court, the ad hoc tribunals, and so forth. So I'd be really interested to hear your thoughts on the importance of those regional courts and the roles that they play, and also the emergence of the field of international criminal justice. Yes.
Well, as you know, there are only in existence today three international regional human rights courts in Europe, which is sort of held up as the pioneer and has done some tremendous achievements. The Inter-American, which came next, and the African now, which is still very much in the beginning stage. Where I think we should have regional human rights courts is really all over the world. They create a so-called local commitment, more or less, to human rights, and get people used to the idea that there are international tribunals that watch governments. They may be different in different countries, but I think it's critical. For example, we have none in Asia. In Asia, we really would need some sub-tribunals. All of Asia is probably too big for one tribunal. Sub-regional tribunals in Asia would be ideal, but we would need them there. They would create a sort of total different attitude to human rights. Now, Asia in many parts is subject to some of the UN human rights treaties, but that's far away, and treaties and the human rights committees that deal with them don't have the same status, really, or legitimacy that human rights, regional human rights tribunals would have. I should also say that I'm committed to the notion that we should have regional international criminal courts. I don't think that the ICC is enough. Mm-hmm. And we see the problems that we have now in Africa, which I don't think is really the fault of the ICC, but I think it would help, and would have helped if we had some regional courts that would deal also with subjects that the ICC has no jurisdiction over. Drugs, for example, piracy, all kinds, trade and slavery, all of those topics could be dealt with and should be dealt with in regional international criminal courts. And regional international criminal courts would also play a very important role in helping and coordinating the work of the human rights courts. Because the human rights courts only, regional human rights courts only deal with governmental violations of human rights. They don't deal with the violations of the individuals who are really responsible for what the governments did. And that's where it would be extremely useful, because the ICC is just not going to be able to deal with all of those tremendous violations of human rights that are being committed. So I think it would be important. I don't think it would detract from the ICC, because the ICC can only deal with a very limited number, most serious violations of human rights.
Well, let me just ask you a couple of questions around that. Let's stick with the regional human rights courts for a second first. In Latin America, the Inter-American Court is under some pressure or attack at the moment.
Which shows that they're doing a good job.
Yes, I suppose that's right. there's a good bit of, and I think you've got an interesting analysis of that we'd like to hear. The European Court, I think, remains effective, but I don't think there's much of a movement, or we don't see much in Asia to give us hope immediately of a strong regional court. It'd be interesting to get your thoughts on how we move from here to there. First of all, why it's good that courts are getting pushback. I think that's an interesting point of view. I think you've got some good reasons for it. But secondly, how do we move from a planet with a couple of strong regional human rights courts to more than that?
Well, we're beginning to have the ASEAN countries have a commission, a very weak system, but one has to push the idea. Mm-hmm. And I think would be more useful. This is where the UN can do it, push much harder, mm-hmm. Encourage it, and be. I think one pushing is the only political pushing. Mm-hmm. I mean, the Inter-American system, the truth is, the convention was ratified only when President Carter started sending around people to various countries to get them to ratify the American convention. I mean, that's the reality. Much of Central America would never have ratified if his people hadn't gone around. And of course they signed because they thought this is just a lot of, nobody took it very seriously. Hypocrisy, incidentally, I've always felt is a wonderful thing that helps human rights. They all say, of course we don't violate human rights. Yeah. We can sign anything. And they would sign things without making reservations, right, to think whether they should have made reservations, because they thought it would never bite. And then suddenly it begins to bite. So governments have to push. What's happening in the Ukraine today,
right,
the reaction of the European Union and the United States, in a sense, contributed, you saw the withdrawal of, it may be temporary only, but there has to be that same sort of pressure brought on various countries in Asia to say, start drafting some human rights conventions, and then maybe you'll have an easier time dealing with those problems than with far away the UN Human Rights Committee, which really does not deal significantly with it. It's a very important institution, but it's not a court.
One of the points that I think is implicit in what you were saying, and I think you said it before, that in some ways democracies react very differently to these courts than authoritarian governments.
Yeah.
I thought that was an interesting point, and the audience might be interested, would be good for them to hear that. Essentially, that democracies say, oh, we're democracies, wait a second, we're doing the right thing, we're respecting human rights, whereas dictatorships take a bit different position. Yeah.
Well, what I found in Latin America, and you probably know that very well, when the dictators were in power in different countries, they were very concerned about being accused of violating human rights. I mean, they didn't do very much about it, but they always took, they were obedient to human rights institutions. The commission, they cooperated. Now, at least for a while, now countries, they consider themselves to be democratically elected. And that means that they know what human rights is all about, and it's no business of the international community to get into the act. So the Inter-American Commission, for example, today, has a lot of problems, mainly from so-called democratic countries. It never had those problems with the dictatorships, because the dictatorships were in many ways, they were concerned about their positions. Right. Whereas these countries say, we can do anything we want to. Suddenly, intervention in domestic affairs begins to be something that these same leaders in the old days never thought of dealing with. So, I think the human rights field is a fascinating field because one has to know how to play the piano. dealing with different countries at different times. Right. There's no reason today why, just because you're democratically elected, you can't be violating human rights, and they do.
Strong point.
Including, incidentally, the United States. I don't know whether you saw the newspaper today.
Anything in particular?
Yes. I can't resist raising that issue. I don't know whether you saw in the newspaper today that Texas is just getting ready to execute somebody from a group of 51 or so Mexicans who were on death row in various states in the United States. And the International Court of Justice, I was still on the court, decided that their rights under the Vienna Convention were violated. They had a right to access their consul, and they were never given the notice that they had that right. The International Court held that given the fact that they were denied that right, the United States had the legal obligation to ensure that all of these people on death row had a right to have their conviction reviewed to determine whether they were prejudiced by the failure to have been accorded those rights. Mm-hmm. Of course, Texas, for one thing, said that it wasn't bound by the, it wasn't a party to the Vienna Convention on the law, so it didn't have to comply with it. But what's happening today is that a person who was in that group and was never given the rehearing is going to be executed, presumably. The US Supreme Court held that this was an international obligation of the United States, but the Supreme Court lacked the power to do it without congressional legislation. This decision was, I think, the ICJ rendered the decision in I think, 2004 or 2005. This Congress has not acted yet. And if Texas goes ahead and executes, it's a clear violation of the United States obligations. And not only that, here is a person executed who's never had a chance, a right which he had under international law, to have his conviction reviewed. And what's happening? Nothing. Now, if this were a dictatorship, imagine.
Right.
All the world would suddenly pay attention to it. Nobody pays any attention to it.
It's clear Tom was on the International Court of Justice. I think he makes this point with a lot of perception.
I was on the court at the time. As an American.
It's a scandal, really.
As an American to be sitting on this court, and I voted against the United States, which I thought on this case was only the proper thing to do. And then to find that my own country is in a position now where this person is going to be executed. And imagine if this were an American being executed someplace else.
Well, Tom, we wondered if we might.
I'm sorry, I get.
No, you bring a lot of passion
to me
to
after
the issue,
a while.
And you make the point strongly, and I think we should send this tape to Rick Perry and try to get Texas moving in the right direction. I'm with you completely.
Good luck.
I thought we might move a little further south, though, to El Salvador and your experience and your time on the Truth Commission there. It was a UN-established commission. All three of you were appointed by the UN. And I would be really interested to hear your reflection on the commission. Of course, the commission somewhat controversially made the decision to name names. And then, of course, the government passed an amnesty. That is now, I think, before the Constitutional Court. So there's been a number of developments there. But I'd be really interested in what you think the long-term impacts of truth commissions are. El Salvador and beyond, we've had some 40 truth commissions at this stage in various parts of the world, a few of them established by the United Nations system, most of them, I think, arising out of national processes. But how do you see truth commissions play in this question of human rights, justice, and their long-term impact?
I've always thought that courts are very important. Mm-hmm. But so are truth commissions, particularly working together with courts. Mm-hmm. For example, I've often thought that Germany, Nuremberg wasn't enough. Courts cannot really tell a history of a terrible conflict. Truth commissions really can describe mm-hmm. the history of what went on and the causes in a way that, if it is a good truth commission, in a way that courts cannot do. You have individual cases that you deal with. It would have helped Germany after the war, especially in the early days, to have had a impartial truth commission that could have looked at the situation in Germany and tried to analyze what were the causes mm-hmm. so that the generation that was involved in those activities would have gotten a view that they never got. Now, fortunately, now that generation is long gone, and you have a very different Germany today than you had then. But for example, in the Bosnian conflict, mm-hmm. I think it would have helped next to the tribunal. Even though it's not easy to have a truth commission and have a court at the same time because of the difficult problems. A truth commission has to be able to get testimony, and that has to be coordinated somehow procedurally with how courts operate. And it's not an easy thing.
Sierra Leone was not an experiment that went so well, right?
Yes, but I think it can be done. Mm. But it would be extremely important, especially in smaller countries. In El Salvador, we were really able to, in a relatively short period of time, to sort of capture the causes and deal with the issues. The problem in El Salvador turned out to be today, it's really common crimes more than mm-hmm. than political issues. Mm. But truth commissions are very important. They don't take the place of courts, but I don't think courts take the place of truth commission either. And they're very important. I think in South Africa, too, they played an important role. Even though individuals, you can criticize it because you feel these people got off. But getting criminals off is not necessarily a bad thing under certain circumstances. Mandela has proved it.
You had said something you'd written something along the lines that the most important role of a truth commission is to tell the truth. I think you said that, which you said sounds trite, but it's not. And I wondered you might expand on that a little bit. It seems pretty fundamental that they ought to be telling the truth, but a lot of truth commissions now have a lot of other responsibilities in a sense, or they're given mandates that cover all kind of different issues. So I'd be interested to hear what your thought was behind truth commissions telling the truth.
Well, when you sit on a truth commission, the thing that you worry the most about is that you're going to make a finding that turns out to be totally wrong. For example, you identified somebody, and we identified by name individuals responsible for certain terrible acts. And imagine, and then it turns out that the person wasn't there. It destroys your entire work. So we were unbelievably careful over and over and over to make sure that when we named somebody, that we knew for sure. And as a result, of course, some people that we weren't so sure about escaped being named, and that's of course part of what happened. I thought when we were criticized by some of these people, it was a wonderful criticism. I really enjoyed it. We were referred to as these arrogant foreigners. Now, I'd always like to be called an arrogant foreigner than somebody who lied. Right. We were the arrogant foreigners. None of these people argued that we were wrong. That's what I mean by right. telling, but it means it's hard work. So it's not an easy, truth commissions aren't easy. We actually decided to name names. We didn't intend originally, but we found out just a short period before that the government was going to give amnesties. Mm-hmm. So instead of being able to recommend that they be tried, we thought, well, the least you can do, because the names were so important to the people whose loved ones were treated as traitors and killed in El Salvador, to at least be able to say, yes, it's not that I am telling you my child, sister, but it's an international commission that says this man was the traitor and the criminal, not my husband, not my brother, not my sister. So it's a tremendously important institution for the next generations, probably much more so than courts. But I don't want to be misunderstood. I believe in courts.
I believe you. But that does bring me to the issue or question of education, because it's something you talk about a lot, the importance of education. And I think you're quite passionate about the importance of
I seem to be too passionate and from about too many things. My wife is here, so I have to be careful.
I realize that. I'm going to tone this down quickly. but yeah, you've talked a good bit about education, and of course, Germany in some ways is an excellent example of how the curriculum changed as in response to justice initiatives, to the Nuremberg trials, to the Frankfurt trials, to a generation in the 60s who said to their fathers, their grandfathers, where were you, and so forth. And I'm interested to hear your thoughts on, as an educator too, how you see the role of transitional justice, human rights, and education, and what we can do to advance that.
You know, I've always, the thing about when one talks about human rights education, it's not as sexy about as talking about courts.
Now you're commission. In trouble with your wife. So.
Yes. but you have to look at the history of Germany to see, you know, 60 some years ago, Germany was a killer nation. And today it's probably the most democratic country in Europe. Education. It took a long time. Some generations had to die. But that was achieved in Germany because of education. Careful, concentrated education. So it gives one faith that it is really possible through education to transform nations. But it means you really have to work at it. And the Germans worked at it in the way only Germans know how to work systematically, and with some fascinating programs. They established actually a whole federal institution, the Bundeszentrale für politische Bildung, a federal office for political education that helped teachers and others distributed material. Tremendous job over a long period of time. And it wasn't easy in the beginning. I know because I was in school in Germany after the war. Imagine, I come out of the camp and I go to school in Germany, and my teachers, some of those who were party members at some point or another, never touched the subject in history of the Holocaust or the Second World War. We were dealing with medieval history. But today, it's unbelievable what's happening in Germany.
I recall, I think in the book, where, as you were saying, they were teaching about the Greeks and the Romans, and you went to your mother, and your mother then went to the headmaster, and I think the curriculum changed. So that's an advocacy in action, I suppose.
Well, my mother was very special. But
I know we're pretty much out of time. I wonder if I can ask you just one or two quick final questions. I'm out of time. You presaged it though, and maybe just a word or two. You mentioned, first you asked me about a lucky child, and I was going to preserve that for the last question. Then I decided Mandela would be the last question, and you mentioned Mandela, and Mandela has just passed from the scene. And I just wondered if you had any thoughts or reflections, because in many ways, his struggle resembles your struggle a bit for human rights and for justice. And since we're, I think, on the verge of his funeral, if you had any thoughts about Mandela, and then we'll open it up for a few questions.
I mean, everything that needs to be said about this great man has already been said. But it shows really what can be done with the commitment to reconciliation after terrible conflicts. Mm. Germany is one example, South Africa another. And then you see countries that haven't figured it out yet, that still haven't done it. Mm-hmm. And it's hard to believe why some, and I don't need to mention them, that still haven't apologized for what they've done. And the failure to apologize just breeds more hatred, and it continues. Whereas if they simply said terrible things happened, it was a different generation, we apologize, we hope never to do it, and let's get together and be friends, and we don't. And then you've got problems in Asia today that could have been solved years and years ago. So I think Mandela taught all of us what reconciliation is all about.
Well, Tom, this is a great conversation. What we want to do is expand it out and take a few questions, and we have microphones in both rows. And if you would go to the microphone, and if you could just state your name and affiliation. There's one on each side. And while you rush to the microphones, I did want to announce that some of you will get a free book, A Lucky Child. Those of you who are sitting on this picture, some of you will be sitting on these on this picture.
I should have made it thicker.
You should have made it thicker. So you can get it in the back. I should have said in the beginning, Tom, this is a little bit of a surprise, but we're on Twitter tonight, and we're on Facebook. I'm on Facebook, but not Twitter. I'm sure you're on both.
I'm on neither.
But we have had a question or two come through on Twitter, and what I thought I would do, well, we'll see if we get any other questions from the audience, but and this is from Twitter, and I'm interpreting this is literally what it says. What does Judge Buergenthal think would help right now? Would a truth commission help the transition? And I suspect that is a kind of broader question, which you've already begun to you answered a little bit earlier.
I apologize, David, but maybe I didn't write it clearly. It refers to Egypt, specifically
Egypt.
To Egypt.
No wonder I was confused by the question. I don't see Egypt on here, but why don't we make it about Egypt, Tom? Let's make it easy, okay?
Couldn't we make it about South Africa? It's so much easier.
So in the situation in Egypt, or if you'd like to take a different country, it'd be Twitterer would be interested to know what a truth commission might do right now. Of course, the situation in Egypt is very difficult from a political point of view, and you know, one of the questions we always deal with is there political space for these transitional justice mechanisms, whether they're criminal prosecutions, whether the truth commissions or reparations programs, et cetera. And obviously, if there's no political space or political will to do this appropriately, then I think it can be instrumentalized for pretty bad purposes. So yeah. I'd be interested your answer to the question.
I really think a truth commission doesn't work in the midst of a conflict. Mm-hmm. You have to have reached a truth of some sort, or because right now it wouldn't do anything. But once, if there is a peace situation, or at that point, you might be able to do it, to have it, and I think it would be very useful in Egypt because so many things have happened there that just the accountability for the transition, for what was done, it could be extremely useful. But I think it's too early. This is not the time. It just wouldn't work there, I don't think, at this moment. Mm. I was afraid somebody would ask me about Syria the same question, and this would be even worse. That doesn't mean that some people shouldn't start thinking about a truth commission for Egypt already. It's never too early to think about it. I understand, for example, that South Korea has already thought of a truth commission when unification comes, whenever it's going to be. Mm-hmm. So, and they are very optimistic, obviously. But I think one has to start early to think about it. And I think Egypt would be a good thing to start, get a few people from that country to think about it, come up with various proposals, but let them lie. This isn't the time, I don't think.
Yeah, I think this is a question that we've actually written about. We have a publication on Syria because you may have seen there have been proposals for a tribunal immediately. I'm very unclear on what basis of legitimacy. Generally, you would have to have a Security Council mandate or an agreement between the country and the United Nations. And to some extent, I think this is thinking about it is important, but we have to realize that transitions take time. There have to be political spaces, and if we want to avoid a situation like Iraq, for example. We saw the consequences of trying to use transitional justice mechanisms when the preconditions weren't there. I don't know whether you share
yes,
those views.
Very much so, right. Yes.
I'd be also interested to take a question from the audience, and we have one right here.
My name is Charlie Clements. I teach human rights at the Harvard Kennedy School. In the last year, there was a pretty concerted effort by a few nations to really weaken the Inter-American Court and the Commission and the Convention. That moment has passed, but I wondered if you would comment on Venezuela pulling out of the entire system and what that bodes for some of those other countries that were trying to weaken the system.
Yes, no, I thank you for the question because Venezuela has pulled out. And it looked for a moment as if some other countries like Bolivia and others might do the same thing, Ecuador. It hasn't happened yet. And the reaction in generally at the OAS has dealt rather effectively with the withdrawal. In some ways, Venezuela withdrew and everybody knew that they withdrew because of what they were doing. Venezuela was violating the convention left and right. The commission was rendering proper decisions in this case. And in order to escape responsibility, Venezuela withdrew. I don't think it proves anything. Venezuela hasn't gained anything, on the contrary. Venezuela will be back, just like a lot of other countries in the past came back. So I don't think it weakens at all. In some ways, it strengthened it because it shows that Venezuela is taking the commission and the court seriously. If they weren't bothered by it, they wouldn't have withdrawn. But they paid a they are paying a political price. So I don't, I mean, it's sad to see, because it's sad to see because of what's happening in Venezuela, not because they withdrew, because their withdrawal tells the entire story.
We have another question here. I've got a few more questions too, but let's go with the question back here.
Hi, you mentioned the increase of sub-tribunals as one way to better international law and accountability. What do you think of universal jurisdiction as another weapon in the search for better accountability yes. in the international arena?
Thank you. Why don't we take two questions?
One
on the other side, and we'll take two, and then we'll take two more.
Hi, it is a pleasure and honor to be here with you tonight. Natasha Govedarica, coming from Balkan, here in the framework of the Fellowship on Historical Dialogue and Accountability, Columbia University. So I wonder, how do you see the consequences of the ruling of ICJ in the case of Bosnia against Serbia accusation for the genocide? And another question, do you read and are you interested in the literature on Holocaust, and what is kind of your like favorite author or book that you like?
Let me answer the last yeah. question first, if I may.
Please.
I don't read anything. I've never read any book on the Holocaust. Mm-hmm. I can't. It's very strange. I can write about it. I can talk about it. I cannot read about it. I cannot watch it on television. It just, and I've asked a lot of people whose judgment in these psychological matters I respect, and I can't get the answer. I just see it on television, for example, and I can't, it gets to me. Mm-hmm. For example, my wife and I have now developed a sort of approach. Sometimes she will go to look at the movie first to see whether it is something that I can see. So she gets to see it twice. She doesn't think it's a great benefit, but but actually we had this one experience. Life is beautiful. We were told by friends, this is a movie you have to see. And you know, without thinking, something like Life is Beautiful sounded like something that you would obviously want to see. And we are sitting there, and suddenly I see the trains. Mm. And I immediately walked out. We just couldn't continue. So the answer is, fortunately or unfortunately, I don't read those books.
No. You had a second question there about Bosnia versus Serbia. I don't know when.
Yes, I should tell you, I did not sit on the case. I recused myself.
Yeah.
Well, I didn't think, what do I think about the case? I think the case is often criticized. I think I better not. My colleagues decided the case and without my help, and I thought they did a good job. One could criticize it for different reasons or like it for different reasons. It was a difficult case to be decided. I should tell you this, that regardless of the outcome, I think this decision of the court will be probably the leading guideline for cases relating to genocide, whether or not you like the outcome. It's the case. It's something that we should teach and study about the Genocide Convention. It gives a totally a different, important perspective and interpretation of what the Genocide Convention means. So I think it's a very important case. And I'm sorry I didn't sit on it. It's sort of one of the few human rights cases that the ICJ had during my period, and I didn't sit on it because I felt that having served on the UN, on the Holocaust Museum's Committee on Conscience and having taken some decisions, it was improper for me to sit on the case.
Tom, you had another question about universal jurisdiction
yes.
earlier.
On universal jurisdiction, it sounds exciting. Universal jurisdiction is a dangerous tool. It can be politicized, can be used. In some ways, I think the ICC is taking the place of universal jurisdiction. and it should be. There are occasions when universal or quasi-universal jurisdiction is useful, but very often universal jurisdiction is a very dangerous weapon because it can be misused for political reasons. And I would much rather see criminals, those who've committed some of these terrible crimes, be tried in an international court like the ICJ, like the ICC, or if I ever persuade anyone to establish a regional human rights, a criminal courts in such courts. But I see it's very dangerous. It's already been, in certain instances, used wrongly. So I think I'm not in favor of it, at least not across the board.
Tom, with the states that, of course, the ICC is only ratified by 121 states, so there are a number of states that aren't in the ICC. So maybe in those states that...
Well, one has to be very careful. Yeah. I think courts, especially in extradition situations, universal jurisdiction, you have some control. But it's a propaganda tool often, and I think it's dangerous. Okay. And it also diminishes the value of human rights and the respect that human rights institutions and international criminal courts should enjoy.
I suspect this could be debated a good bit further, but we have three more questions now. And I think why don't we take all three
down. I'm getting old and my memory is
I will write them all down, Tom, great. So we'll be in good shape, I promise. So why don't we take the two here and then the one here.
My name is David Benger, and I'm a student at Brandeis University. And it's an honor to be here to see you speak, Judge Buergenthal.
Thank you.
My question regards how the ICC specifically fits within a political context. There have been criticisms regarding the pressure to convict, that the Lubanga charges were too sleek, there were no sexual violence charges, that Ngojola was acquitted, all kinds of other pressure that the court is facing to really show some results to fulfill their mandate of ending a culture of impunity. And yet there have been accusations by witness tampering by the prosecution. So I guess my question is, how do you think the court has or should strike that balance between the political pressure that's on it to come up with results and the somewhat slow, tedious trials that the court has undertaken or has had to undertake because of the volume of evidence and because of the complexity of the legal questions?
Okay, we'll take that. I must say I'm not familiar with the allegations of witness tampering, I don't think. Yeah, I think there's some of the other points are interesting, but Yale?
Hi, I'm Yael Danieli. Hi, Tom.
Hi.
The question I have relates to your statement that you cannot, that you would not and cannot, you choose your words, watch Holocaust-related films or read the books. And our young Balkan colleague here, because I was actually in The Hague, you might remember, when the judgment came up, and working in the Balkans. And they actually wouldn't come to The Hague on that day. And they said they would never come to The Hague because of the impact. But my actual question is then, how would a judge with a victimization history listen to victims? I think it's an important challenge, and I think we discussed some of that a while back. But I think, particularly because the ICC is as progressive as it is, at least in terms of the statutes and the rules with regard to victims and victims' participation, et cetera, would you reflect more on that, on the victim's point of view, the victim's experience in courts, and even in truth commissions, because you basically said that the court would not provide a history, the truth commissions would. I would leave it at that. I'm trying to sort of grasp a different trained here.
David, could I answer that question first?
Now, please do.
Before
please
I forget it.
Yeah.
I think it's a very, very important question. And I've thought a lot about it because I've felt affected by it. I'll give you sort of some examples. When I served on the UN Human Rights Committee, we had a case from a Holocaust denier, a very famous one from France, and who denied really that Auschwitz is, he thought Auschwitz was sort of a nice retreat type thing. And here I was, and he was appealing a conviction in France. But it was clear to me that I had to recuse myself. There was just no question. I recused myself in a way that I wasn't really a recusal, because I said that as somebody who survived the Auschwitz concentration camp, whose parents, whose father, whose maternal grandparents, and others who died in the Holocaust, I feel I cannot participate in the case, which was stating my view, but since I wasn't participating, it was okay. But it was clear to me that I couldn't participate. The problem that I always had, both on the Inter-American Court and also in El Salvador, was that I always felt I had an obligation not to identify with the victims, because sometimes I probably might have sort of leaned in the wrong way, because I felt I could understand the victim. For example, the case that to me is always one that I think about, when the survivor of the El Masote massacre in the Salvador case was interviewed by us, the members of the Salvador Truth Commission, she started talking about what happened at the massacre. And within a minute or a half, I could have finished her story. I could have been the witness. I could have said what was going on, what happened there, because it was so similar to what happened, for example, when the closing of the ghetto in Kelse, what they were doing to people. So there is this risk. At the same time, when you hear somebody, you know whether it's true or not, because you know you've heard these stories. On that note, incidentally, I should point out, I've always, and I keep saying this all over, how similar the cruelty of human beings. We never come up with imaginative cruelties. It's always the same. You look at Solzhenitsyn, at the Gulag, you look at the German concentration camp, you look what's happening in all countries. It's always the same, which is, fortunately, they don't come up with even more imaginative, terrible things to do, but it's always the same. And that's what sort of was always in my mind when I saw, for example, the Jesuit father, where they were killed and what happened. It's not easy. At the same time, I think somebody who's experienced some of it in sort of in its own skin has probably a better sense of sitting on the tribunal, but has to be very careful, because not every supposed victim is a supposed victim, not every victim tells the truth, and all of these things has to be very carefully weighed. But it is, it was with me all the time.
We have one more question here, and then we can go back to the previous question as well, please.
My name is Meetha Nandagopalan. I'm a graduate of NYU, and I'm currently a public school teacher. And as such, I'd like to go back to what you were saying earlier about education and the role of education in transforming post-conflict regions. You specifically spoke about Germany. And I'm wondering if you have any thoughts on what made those programs in the decades following the Holocaust successful to the extent that they were. What about them could be replicated in other regions experiencing or having emerged from conflicts, and what was specific to Germany and must be specific to the country?
Do you want to take that one, and then we can go back to the previous question?
Okay.
Take that one, Tom.
Well, of course, education has to be country-specific in a general sort of way. But the important thing with education is in human rights education, that it is based on the truth, on what happened, and addresses the crimes that were committed, and then tries to understand in an educational way what happened, and then tries to understand how it can be avoided, how it can be prevented, what happened. And a curriculum can be built around it. It also, of course, that tolerance and reconciliation has to be built into a curriculum of that sort. I'm giving you something that you will say is totally useless, but it's the only way I can tell you how you would go about it, what the ingredients have to be. The ingredients have to be that you have to face the truth to start with about what happened in that country. That's not always easy, particularly not when the generation responsible for those acts is still around and has political power. That's one of the difficult situations. To that extent, Germany, having had 60-some years, had an easier point of it because most of the real perpetrators were no longer there. So it was only the grandchildren today and great-grandchildren of the perpetrators who have really understood the lesson of the education that the country got in the past 60 years. But the ingredients are there, the truth is critically important. And then try to build on reconciliation, on tolerance, and some other things. For example, you know, we don't often, except for the Nobel Peace Prize, what do kids in school learn about the great military heroes? You think they often deal with human rights heroes, resistance heroes? Mm-hmm. Those are things that have to get into a curriculum. And that's politically not always easy with the older generation, but it has to be there. So for every general who's mentioned as a great hero, let's hear about a great human rights fighter in that same country. For example, the July uprising against Hitler. Those were considered traitors at one point in Germany. They were hanged, but they were the real heroes in Germany of the resistance. Those things have to stand out. So wherever, in whatever environment you are, they're heroes and there are others. But the human rights heroes have to be honored in ways. And people who have done great things in helping need to be named and respected, and that takes time. I wish I could sort of write the prescription. It doesn't work that way. Every country is a little different.
Tom, although there are other questions out there, I think that that's an answer to really end on, because as we think about human rights heroes, being here with you in this tonight.
I mean real heroes.
Real heroes, real heroes. It's great to be a real hero with a real hero like yourself, and to be here in New York with you tonight. And thank you for your time and for all of your great work on for causes of justice, human rights, transitional justice. The world is very appreciative. And thank you very much. And it's been a great evening with you.
Thank you.